Happy Easter and welcome to Mission Hill Church Online. We are so glad you're able to join us today.
As you're tuning in, you can expect an exciting time of worship and an encouraging message from Pastor Paul. You can also leave your prayer requests down in the comments section, and we have pastors and other people standing by ready to connect with you online.
We are able to have church online because of generous giving from people like you. So we ask that you continue in the spirit of generosity by giving.
And the easiest and best way to do that is online. You can give through our app or at our website, missionhillchurch.com.
Again, thanks for joining us. Now let's worship together.
No other king could vanquish the war horse or silence the warrior's rage while riding the lowly back of a donkey. No other king could break the dominion of darkness, the tyranny of evil, with a reign of grace and a kingdom of peace. No other king could give his life for the redemption of rebels, his wealth to welcome the outcast. Jesus is that King, the King of glory, Son of the living God. Not just another king, not just another prophet, not just another teacher. He was the one the world had been waiting for, the one to deliver us from captivity, the Son of David and Abraham's chosen seed. He is the goal of the Mosaic Law, Yahweh in the flesh. He is the one to establish God's reign and rule, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, freedom to the prisoners, and proclaim good news to the poor. This Jesus was the Creator come to earth and the beginning of a new creation. He embodied the covenant, fulfilled the commandments, and reversed the curse. This Jesus is the Christ that God spoke of to the serpent, the one prefigured to Noah in the flood, the one promised to Abraham, the one guaranteed to Moses before he died, the one promised to David during his reign, the one revealed to Isaiah as a suffering servant, the one predicted through the prophets and prepared for through John the Baptist. He is the Father's Son, Savior of the world, and substitute for our sins. More loving, more holy, and more wonderfully terrifying than we ever thought possible. He is our Jesus, and there is no other King like him. He is our God, our glory, our victorious Savior. There is no other King like him. There is no other king.
From heaven you came running. our storms move for good, for the Lamb conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel through the world shall not kneel, shall not fade. By His blood, in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Oh, praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, free in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
We stand in victory today because Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, has conquered sin, death, hell, and the grave. We can have victory today.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. Because the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. 'Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. In every war He wages, He will win. So I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know.
Faith, we say,
you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Yes, you do.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good.
You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Everlasting Father, we thank you so much for such a wonderful opportunity to worship again, to celebrate the name of the Lord in this holy weekend. Lord, we give you the glory as we remember, oh Father, the reason of our life, oh Father. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your obedience to the cross. You died for our sin and our salvation is certain, oh God. We thank you for paying the cost of our sin that we can come out free. Oh Lord, we thank you for the gift of victory. You have won victory over death, over Satan, over the world. You become victorious and you have given us victory. Lord, I strongly believe the same Lord that was able to save us from sin and death, you are able to save us, oh God, today from the devastation of coronavirus in the name of Jesus. So God, help the sick, protect the healthy, oh God. Come to the rescue of the needy in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray even right now that the true message of the gospel of Christ Jesus that will be preached in a moment, oh God, will reach out, oh God, to the hearts of the needy. Oh Lord, for the unsaved, oh God, to receive the light and salvation of Christ Jesus. So Father, we thank you. Bless our present worship team, oh Father. Bless Pastor Paul and use him powerfully, oh God, before the throne of grace, oh Father. May you, oh Lord, ordain your powerful words, oh God. Your word is life and spirit through his mouth, oh Father, to convince our hearts, oh Father, in righteousness. Father, we thank you. We give you all the glory, Jesus. We worship your name. We lift your name up because it is paid all in total, oh God, the depth of our sin. Oh Jesus, we bless your holy name. We worship you and glorify your name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Jesus.
Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
On February 29th, 2012, I was shot in the head in a drug deal gone bad. As I pulled into a parking lot in North St. Louis, I got out of my car to get the drugs that I was about to sell to men. And as I got back into my car, I felt a gun pressed up against my head. What felt like an eternity was the moment that would change my life forever. The gun did go off that night. The man in the back had leaned back and pulled the trigger, and as that bullet passed through my shoulder, passed through my brain, and stopped resting on my left eye, I was knocked out instantly. I don't know how long I was out for, but by God's grace, I was able to wake up and call 911. And as I remember all the details leading up to the moment I was in the ambulance, I blacked out once I got in, and 2 days later, I woke up. And as I laid in that bed with half my skull missing, I began to reflect on my life. I realized that everything that I had hoped in, everything that I had placed my faith and trust in, everything that I had worked for up until that moment was shattered. I was completely ashamed, and everyone in my town that I had grown up in knew what happened. I worked for the next 6 weeks to learn how to walk again, and I worked through occupational therapy and physical therapy, but I can look back now and see that as God was helping me to walk again physically, he was also teaching me how to walk with him spiritually. God was placing a desire in my heart for him. And as I walked out, I realized that God was leading me into a new life. God was leading me spiritually to follow him. And as I began to attend church, my love for his church grew. And I heard the story of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. I heard the story about the man who was raised from the dead 4 days after he had been in the tomb, Jesus saying, "I am the resurrection. I am the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet he shall live." So yeah, I was shot in the head. You probably weren't. But what you and I have in common is sin. Sin separates us from God. But Jesus came to pay the ultimate price so that you and I could walk in freedom. And so today, I praise the one that paid the price for everyone who believes in him. I'm Connor, and I'm a resurrected life in Jesus.
Oh, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Happy Easter. Christ is risen. And I know that wherever you are right now, you're responding in the way that Christ followers have for 2,000 years. He is risen indeed. And the resurrection of Jesus is the focus of our time together. Just as you heard Connor share his story, as you heard the song sing, Jesus paid it all, because of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you and I can have the resurrected life. That was something that was so important to Paul Robert Snyder. He was an evangelical pastor who lost his life in Nazi Germany at the hands of the Nazis, all because he stood on the undeniable truth of the resurrection. He had been a preacher that preached the resurrection for many years, but it was in the funeral service of a young man from his village that he really got into trouble. He had completed the funeral, and at the end of the funeral, a Nazi leader stood up, and this is what the Nazi leader said. This young man has already risen in spirit to join Hurst Wetzel, the stormtroopers on high. You see, the Nazis had really required that you believe in the supernatural, because they believed that this Hurst Wetzel, the one who had wrote the anthem to the Nazis, when he died, was resurrected, and he was on high developing an army of, I guess, heavenly stormtroopers. And so he asserted that this young man had joined Hurst Wetzel. Well, Paul Robert Snyder did not like that. So he responded with these words: no one will rival the risen Lord Jesus here in this place. That led to his arrest, eventually intimidation, humiliation, imprisonment. He was released for a season, but continued to preach the risen Christ, and eventually his life was taken by lethal injection. You would think that's the end of the story. But it's not, because it was found out that he had written six letters to his children. In one of those letters, he wrote these words: Christ may not be seen in every deed, but he's present in every hour, because he is the risen Lord. He is with us now. That's the message of the resurrection. It's not just about eternal significance. It's about daily consequence. The resurrection of Jesus affects you right here, right now. I believe that's why Jesus said in that seventh saying of his, I am the resurrection and the life. I love what Warren Wiersbe says about this. He says, he moved resurrection out of the statement of faith into a person, out of the future and into the present. Christianity is not just a religion or a statement of faith. Christianity is Christ. It's all about Jesus. And here's what I want you to know this Easter weekend. Jesus is present right here, right now. And you see that as you look at these I am statements of Jesus. We've looked at seven of them. Today is the seventh. Jesus first said, I am the bread of life. He was saying, I'm your source. I'm your satisfaction. I'm your salvation. Right here. Right now. He would say, I am the light of the world. Why? Because he wants to form us. He wants to fill us. He wants to make darkness flee from us. Right here, right now. Jesus said, I am the door. Why? Because he wanted to give us entrance into God's presence. He wanted to give us access to an abundant life. Not someday, but right here, right now. Jesus would say, I am the good shepherd. I know you. I know everything about you, your name, your nature, your deepest needs, even right here, right now. I am the way, he would say, the truth and the life, because he gives us a pathway filled with promise, and he gives us peace even in the midst of difficult circumstances. That means for you and I, right here, right now.
And then Jesus would say, I am the true vine. Why? Because he wants us connected to him. Because when we're connected to Jesus, our lives bear fruit for his glory. Jesus gave us these statements so that we could know he is our right here, right now God. He was, he is, he forevermore shall be. And that's at the core of this last statement. I am the resurrection and the life. Look with me in John chapter 11, beginning in verse 1. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. You recognize these names. Those of us that know scripture know that this was the Mary who would anoint Jesus' feet with her perfume. This is Mary and Martha. One was busy in the kitchen. The other was spending time with Jesus. These were close friends. Notice what happens. The sister sent to him saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. Think about that for a moment. They sent a message to Jesus. If you could send a text message to Jesus right now, what would it be? What would you say to him? Oh God, I need you. Get here quick. That's not what they said. They didn't appeal to Lazarus's problem. They dealt with Jesus's passion. In this moment of crisis, they appealed to his compassion. Now that needs to tell you something. Your life, even in a moment of crisis, captures the concentration of Jesus. He cares about what you're facing. Notice how this passage continues. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. It's for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed there 2 days longer in that place where he was. I laugh because that's a passage hard to understand, even as I read the word. Jesus loved them. So he just kind of waited. He wasn't ready to respond to their needs. Why in the world would we have that description of what Jesus did in this passage of Scripture? I think there are some things we want to learn from the life of Mary and Martha and Lazarus. This very familiar passage of Scripture. Here's the first thing. When Jesus is involved, waiting is never wasted. Your waiting time is never wasted time. Why is that? I think it's for this reason. When Jesus is involved, he wants us to understand that if we will see our lives through the filter of God's glory, everything will be changed. Do you look at your life asking this question? Am I giving glory to Jesus? Is my life glorifying God? As hard as it is to digest, Jesus was saying, my design for you is greater than your desire. Have you embodied that in your life? Are you allowing Jesus to work in and through you so that he might be glorified? Jesus said, I'm going to wait so that the Father may be glorified in this moment. But there's another reason. I want you to see the other reason. Let's continue reading. Verse 11. After saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he's fallen asleep, he will recover. Now, Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking a rest in sleep. So I think Jesus probably just sighed here. Once again, the boys don't get it. The disciples do not understand. So Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, you knuckleheads. And for your sake, I'm glad I was not there, so that you might believe. Now the disciples respond. In fact, it goes on to say that Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us then go so that we may die with Jesus also. In other words, okay, Jesus, you're going to this place where we know they want to arrest you. You know they want to kill you, but you're going because of your friend. We'll go with you. But they missed what Jesus had said. Jesus had said, I'm going there so that you might believe. Sometimes those waiting moments in our life are allowed by God so that our faith might grow. Look at your life right now, your little corner of the world. Is there anything you're going through that God could be allowing for the growth of your faith? God isn't always going to answer our prayers in the way that we expect. Sometimes God answers in ways greater than what we could have imagined. That's what was taking place here. God already knew what was going to take place. Jesus already knew his plans, but it wasn't plans for a healing. It was plans for a resurrection. Their faith needed to grow. We've had moments like that, haven't we? Moments like Mary and Martha, where we wondered if Jesus was going to respond to our needs. Notice what happens next. Look at verse 17. When Jesus came, he found Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, this is significant because in ancient Jewish custom, they believed that for the first 3 days, the soul would come back to the dead body, kind of check things out, and consider whether or not it was going to re-inhabit the dead body. It was now the fourth day. The body had already begun to disfigure. No chance of life. 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you." And Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, I know he'll rise again on the resurrection on that last day. And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." And Jesus was saying, "Martha, you don't need what I can do. Martha, you need who I am. You don't need the answer to your deepest desires. You need me." "Do you believe this?" Jesus asked her. She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe you are the Christ, the Son of God, who's coming into the world." But we've all had moments like that, haven't we? Like Martha in verse 21, "Lord, if you would have been here, if this would have happened, or if that would have happened." We go through life with a lot of ifs, but in this if, she was pointing the finger squarely at Jesus. Maybe you've done that. "Oh God, where were you when I was abused? God, where were you when I went through my divorce? God, where were you when I lost everything I have? If you had been there." And in answer to this question, Jesus says, "I am." Don't miss this. As we've been studying these statements of Jesus, we've been declaring this truth. "I am" changes who I am. When I understand who he is, it changes who I am. And in this moment, Jesus answering the question, "If you had been here," says, "I am." It's the same words that we find God saying to Moses at the burning bush. In the Greek Septuagint, it's described this way, "Ego eimi." Same words that Jesus utters. He says, "I was, I am, I forevermore shall be." In other words, "Martha, I was here, I am here, I'll forever be here." Then he asked, "Do you believe this?" And you and I have to answer that question. Do I believe that Jesus is my right here, right now, God? Well, before we move on, this passage teaches us another important truth about those waiting times. I want you to get this today. God's delays are not necessarily God's denials. God always answers our prayers. You know that, right? Sometimes God says, "Yes, you got it." Sometimes he says, "No, not a chance." And at other times God says, "Wait. Because I've got something better. I've got something coming your way that's going to give me greater glory. It's going to grow your faith. And it's going to allow us to go forward for the better." God's design is always better than our desire. But the story continues. Look at verse 28. When she had said this, she went and she called her sister Mary, saying in private, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in place where Martha had met him. We weren't surprised earlier to see Martha running to Jesus. She always does that. But now Mary has run to meet him. When the Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Hey, a side point here. She fell at her feet. Worry always breeds fear and distances us from Jesus. But worship always draws us close. Mary falls at his feet, but then she says the same thing. We can all relate to this. If you had been here, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her were also weeping. He was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. So everybody's upset by this. And he says, "Where have you laid him?" Is this because he didn't know? No, Jesus knew where the body was. But sometimes God wants us to process in the midst of where we are, where he is. They said to him, "Lord, come and see." And then verse 35, maybe the shortest verse in Scripture, one we can all memorize, very important verse, Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." You can't read this story without seeing and sensing the love of Jesus for Mary and Martha and for Lazarus. But you can't read this story without seeing and sensing that God has that same kind of love for you. And that really leads us to this second truth. When Jesus is involved, our waiting is not wasted. But when Jesus is involved, our weeping is never wasted. You've gotten so discouraged, so depressed. You face those difficult and those down times. And you've wondered if God was there and if God cared. And the answer is yes. In fact, did you know the Bible says in Psalm 56:8, "You have kept count of my tossings. You've put my tears in your bottle. Are they not in your book?" God feels your pain. He keeps track of your tears. Jesus wasn't weeping because of the sadness of Lazarus' death. He was going to take care of that. Jesus was weeping because his friends were hurting. It's these days as I've watched my ailing dad nearing death, it seems like day by day. I can't talk to him or be around him without tears coming to my mind. But as those tears begin to roll, it's not because of what he is facing. His eternal reward is waiting for him. No, my tears are my sadness just because of what I know my mom is experiencing. And for all of us who love him dearly, and you have a heavenly Father who loves you, who knows what you're facing. He cares about everything in your life. Why? Because he is your right here, right now God. Don't miss this on Easter weekend. Jesus is your right here, right now God. Jesus has already answered two of the biggest life questions. Can God help me? Does he have the power? Does God really care? Does he have compassion? But before we end our time together this weekend, I want you to see, not only is your waiting never wasted, not only is your weeping never wasted. According to this passage, when Jesus is involved, his words are never wasted. The word of God is powerful. In the beginning of the Bible, it tells us that God spoke creation into existence. In the beginning of John, we're told that Jesus is the Word. And now with his words, Jesus demonstrates the power over life and death. Look at verse 38. Then Jesus, deeply moved again. That word deeply moved, it kind of speaks to a grunting horse. I mean, there's a guttural passion. He came to the tomb. It was a cave and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, by this time there'll be an odor, for he's been dead for 4 days." The King James Version said, he stinketh. And maybe you hear that word and you think, man, there are some things in my life that stinketh. Maybe your marriage stinketh. Maybe your career stinketh. Maybe your educational pursuits stinketh. And you're wondering, if things stink so badly, can God really do anything? So Mary says, come on, Jesus, he stinks. Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes, and he said, Father, I thank you that you've already heard me. And then it's like he may have kind of whispered to his heavenly Father, I know you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around so that they may believe you've sent me. And when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! And the man who had died came out, his hands and his feet bound with linen strips, his face wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. When Jesus is involved, words are never wasted. Let me give you four words, or really four phrases that Jesus uttered that I think change everything. The first one is this, take away the stone. That's kind of a peculiar phrase that Jesus gave us there. Why? I think Jesus is reminding us that there are some things that he could do that he chooses not to do. Sometimes God allows us to do the things we can do so that he's freed up to do those things in our life that only he can do. Some of you are looking at your life right now and you're saying, God, if you did this, if you did that, and I believe the first thing he would say to you is move the stone. Do those things that you have the ability, you have the skill to do. But then there's a second phrase. The second phrase is this. Lazarus, come out. Lazarus, come out. Someone said it's a good thing that Jesus called his name. If not, every dead body in the graveyard would have risen. That's true. And the truth is, the Bible says that one day that is what's going to happen. In 1 Corinthians 15:51, it says, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. But we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Hey, make no mistake, the miracle of Easter is not about the resurrection of Lazarus. The miracle of Easter is that the one who said, I am the resurrection and the life, would die on a cross. He would be buried in a tomb, and he would become the only person in human history to raise himself from the dead. And because of his resurrection, because of the life that he enjoyed, you and I can experience life. The Bible says that one day, this same Jesus is coming again. And everyone who's ever lived throughout history, who has begun a relationship with Jesus Christ, will be raised once and for all. And just like Jesus had that glorified body, we'll have glorified bodies in eternity with him. The greatest miracle that Jesus ever does is to offer us a life that death cannot defeat. I need to just take a minute and tell you, I've experienced that life. Have you? It was when I was a young boy that I knelt down in my backyard. I hadn't had a lot of sin in my life, at least not the grievous kinds that you and I think of. I was raised in church in a pastor's home, so I like to say I had a drug problem. I was drugged to church Sunday night, Sunday morning, Monday night, Wednesday night. All of my life I was at church. But as a young boy, I recognized that I was a sinner and that sin, if left undealt with, would keep me from God's promise of heaven, and it would keep me from experiencing all that he had enjoyed for my life right here. So I knelt there in my backyard and I confessed my sin to God. I told him, I believe, Jesus, that you died on the cross, and I believe that you're alive today, and I want you to come into my heart and live. And you know what that meant? Because I made that decision as a young boy, because Jesus came into my life, that meant as I would go through life and face illness or face a serious car accident or face uncertainty that I didn't understand, I could count on the fact that I need not fear, even death, because I had been changed by Jesus Christ. That's my story. I want to encourage you with this. In fact, I'll challenge you with this Easter weekend. Would you consider, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, taking just about 60 seconds or so and recording your story And then post it on social media. And you can just use that hashtag, my story. Let others know that you've experienced that same call that Lazarus experienced when Jesus said to him, Lazarus, come out, that you've come out of the grave, that you've experienced new life in Jesus Christ. Some of you have experienced life, but you're living as if you're dead. Remember, the Bible says we're dead to sin. And some of you, you're living as if you're still dead to that sin in your life. That's why I want to take you to this next saying. Jesus said, unbind him and let him go. Did you know that the grave clothes that they would have wrapped Lazarus in could have weighed as much as 100 pounds? That means that when Jesus called him out and the blood began to run through his veins, as his heart began to beat, as his eyes began to open and he began to move, he would not be able to move very much. He looked like a mummy. And some of you, though you've been called out by God, you're living your life as if you've not been let go. You need to let the chains be loosed and move past those things in your past, perhaps even some of those in your present, and let God give you deliverance. For the last of the words of Jesus, though, I want to move you to verse 25 again. In verse 25, it says, Jesus said to her, this is to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Martha answered Jesus, and he said, of course I believe. And one day we're all gonna be raised, Jesus. Yeah, I understand that. She began to make it about religion, about the theology that she had been taught. But that was not what Jesus was talking about. Remember, Jesus is your right now, right here God. And so he was wanting her to understand, I'm talking about the present, Martha. Do you believe I'm all you need? Do you believe this? What about you? Have you come to that place? Have you come to the place of understanding where you literally say, Jesus, I get it. It's not about religion. I could be Baptist or Catholic or Methodist or Lutheran or Assembly of God. Fill in the blank, whatever it is. It's not about ritual. I could have gone through church class or First Communion or confirmation. I could have raised my hand or walked down an aisle. It's not about that. It's about whether or not I really believe that you're my right here, right now, God. Have I come to the place where I understand that Jesus is all I need? So John records these seven sayings of Jesus. And then he records seven miracles. And then at the end of John, in verse 30 of chapter 20, he says this, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Ultimately, those words of Jesus to Martha, that's the most important question you'll have to answer today. It's the most important question you'll answer any day. Do you believe? Do you believe that Jesus is the resurrection and the life? Do you believe that Jesus is present right here, right now? Have you allowed the great I am to change who you are? History records a great story of Lazarus. In Lazarus' later life, he actually became the bishop of Cyprus. And on his tombstone, it said that one of the things that are recorded is, this is Lazarus, who was 4 days dead. But tradition records, late in his life, he was standing before one of the regional rulers, and they asked him to deny Christ, to revoke his faith in Jesus Christ. And he just started laughing. This, of course, incensed the leader. And the leader said, do you not understand? Don't you realize that I can take your life? I can kill you for this. And Lazarus just laughed more. He said, no, you don't understand. I've already died once. I no longer fear death. Been there, done that, got the T-shirt. How about you? Do you fear death? You know, because I made that decision as a young boy in the backyard of my house, because I asked Christ to come in and take control of my life, no matter what I've faced, I've known that He holds my future. You can know that too. Let me remind you once more. The Bible says that you and I are separated from God from the day of our birth because of sin. That's not just something we've done, it's who we are. And the Bible says that that sin will not only eventually destine us to hell, it will one day cause us to miss out on God's best here on this side of heaven. God doesn't want that. So that's why Jesus came as a baby. He lived that perfect life as a man. That's why He performed these miracles and said these statements. That's why He died on the cross and was buried in the tomb and rose from the grave so that you and I could have life and that we could have it abundant. That's God's desire for you. But that'll only take place as you take the opportunity to begin that relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. Have you decided to do that? Or in the words of Jesus, do you believe? If not, why not now? Would you bow your head with me right where you are? And in this moment, I want to invite you, if you've never trusted in Jesus Christ, if you've never said, God, I get it. You're all I need. You are my everything. You were, you are, you forever will be. If you've never done that, why not do that today? This could be the best Easter that you've ever had. And it's simple. All you've got to do is tell God that that's what you want. And you can do that through a prayer. I'll even lead you through that prayer, but I want you to understand it's not magical or mystical. You can go straight to God. You don't need a pastor or a priest. But if you need help in the words to say, maybe you would pray this prayer. Just pray this. Dear Jesus, I know I need you. I am a sinner. I need to be saved. I believe you died for me. And I believe you're alive today. So right here, right now, come into my life and take control. Change me, Jesus. You are my right here, right now, God. I tell Him thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for being the resurrection and the life for me. God, I pray that the decisions that were just made would be so firmly planted in these individuals' lives that they'll be forever held on to as they continue to grow in faith for your glory. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, if you just prayed that prayer with me, I want to say congratulations. Welcome to God's family. That's the most important thing you could ever do. I'm so glad you've done that, and I want you to let us know. So there's a couple ways you can do that. If on the platform that you're watching on, you see a button that says raise your hand, you can just raise your hand right now, and that'll let us know that you prayed to receive Christ and to begin that relationship with Him. But on every one of our platforms, there's a card that I would ask all of you to fill out. It's kind of a communication or a connection card. It gives us your basic information, lets you record prayer requests, but it also gives you a chance to say that today you decided to follow Jesus. You made a decision today to follow Christ. Would you take a minute and fill that out? As you do that, our band and our singers, they're going to come back. They're going to sing a song that's called Living Hope. It's one of my favorite songs now. It comes from the words of Peter. Think about Peter. He moved from being a Christ denier to being the greatest preacher of the resurrection that maybe there's ever been. And Peter teaches us that Jesus is our living hope. As you fill out that card, let's continue to worship Him together.
Jesus Christ, the hope of the world, He is alive today.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my
Hey, thanks again for worshiping with us today. I pray that you have had a blessed Easter. It's because of you and people like you that we're able to provide this online worship experience. Did you know that our people have been so faithful throughout this crisis in the continual giving of their tithes and offerings? I want to remind you that you have the opportunity to do that even today. You can give in at least four ways. You could write a check and drop that off at the church or put that in the mail. The easiest thing and probably the wisest thing to do is to give online. You can do that in three different ways. You can go to your bank and you can schedule something called bill pay, or you can go to our website or our app and give instantly. That's what I'm going to do right now. I found that to be the easiest way to give. Your continued financial faithfulness allows us to continue to provide for those in our community under the shadow of our steeples as we demonstrate the light and the love of Jesus, doing whatever it takes wherever we are. I look forward to worshiping with you again next week. I'm beginning a brand new series. It's called Dream On. Times like these should not cause us to get down in the dumps or into the pit. It should be an opportunity for us to climb out and pursue God's best for our life. That's what we're going to talk about the next several weeks as we look at the life of Joseph. I can't wait to open God's Word, encouraging you to dream on.
What an amazing time of worship we've had. Be sure to follow the links and fill out the forms.
Please continue to spread the word by clicking share on this video. Happy Easter. We'll see you next week.